To say anything about Wim Wenders' 1984 film Paris, Texas is to spoil it. In order to not spoil it, all that can be said is that there is a man wandering in the desert when the film begins, and that this man is wasted and nearly erased. To say anything more would be to undermine the tension around which the film is coiled, to spring loose its energy and thus destroy it, because the film is that tension. No, it is not Hitchcock's ticking time bomb. Rather, Wenders and Sam Shepard, who wrote the script, winds this tale taut around what we might discover about this lost man, what he must discover about himself, what has made him so lost, if he is irrevocably so. This man, played by Harry Dean Stanton, who he was, emerges slowly, eternally, like the face of God from Rock Canyon walls at the measured beatings of Santa Ana winds. This man has a brother who coaxes him back to the living. This man has a son. This man once had a beautiful wife. As the man once more realizes these facts of his life, his soul takes form again, like bones brushed free of dirt in an archaeological dig, taking the form of the once alive. At length, the man sets out upon the road into the landscape, this time with his son. This time, not to become lost, but to face what has broken him, what has broken his family, to possibly mend what has been broken. The man finds that what has broken him is a love-ravaged imagination of great and terrible power. Gazing at the fearful beauty of his wife, the man had seen in her something she wasn't. He imagined her a tramp. He imagined her an infidel. He imagined her as someone who could not possibly love him. Love will make us imagine that which will kill us. Sitting behind the two-way mirror at the peep show where she works, he does not gaze again upon his wife. He knows the destruction such gazes can produce. Instead, he gazes inward. What he finds is that when the cold face of his imagination met the hot front of his love, it produced a force of nature no less destructive than a Bible Belt twister. It was this force that caused him to evacuate his life, a jealousy-spun rage. The man recalls his father. He recalls that his father, by some contortion of his own imagination, came to believe that his mother was from Paris, France, instead of Paris, Texas. This makes sense to the man now. He recalls that he himself was likely conceived in Paris, Texas, and that this was likely where he was trying to get to when he wandered the deserts. It is to this place he sets out for again. This is a beautiful and haunting film that I didn't like either time I tried to watch it, but which I now feel attaching itself to my heart.
Little different introduction from Joe Christiana this time around for their season 5 finale, Joe. That was very, very soft and elegant.
Thank you, Tom.
You're welcome. You're welcome. This is an extraordinary piece of work, to say the least. You know, beginning with Stanton wandering out of the desert, like, you know, like some kind of a beaten, you know, biblical figure.
Yeah.
And the mood is very Western-like, which is, I don't even know if Wenders is aware of any of this. You know, I don't, you know, I mean, I don't know much about the man except for what I've been learning now after watching Paris, Texas. I had not really watched any of his films. I did realize after getting to know him here for this show that I did see a movie called Until the End of the World in the early 90s. So I had watched one of his movies. But back to Paris, Texas. You know, this it's so weird. It's so different.
It's a tough film to wrap your head around, right?
It is, and it isn't.
For me, it was. You know, like it was.
I think
tough for me.
For me, you know, I was certainly able to relate to the young boy in a lot of ways. Growing up fatherless, and my mother, she partied a lot. She was a dancer, and, you know, so I, you know, she wasn't around a lot. She kind of left us to fend for ourselves at one point. There's a lot in this film that I could relate to on a personal level, right. And not to listen. There's so much more than that in this movie, which makes it amazing. But it wasn't difficult. What's interesting to me, Joe, and listening to your intro, is that you had a difficult time with this for one or two screenings before.
Yeah. Well, even for this screen, I've seen it. I saw the first time I watched it, I didn't even watch it all the way through, to be honest with you, man. It was a while ago. It was like a good 10 years ago or something. And let me tell you, Wenders Angel, it's not City of Angels, it's Wings of Desire. Yeah. Is probably one of my favorite films. Like, it's definitely up there in like the top fivers or so. It's one of my favorite films. So it led me to this film. And it's just so slow and so at arm's length that I didn't even watch it to the end. And, you know, I don't know if it was I was tired of watching too many movies. This is back when I was watching like 3 or 4 movies a day. It seemed like pretentious nonsense. Yeah, I know.
It's all about communication in a sense, you know. I mean, to me it was.
Yeah,
with Stanton, his character, being mute, you know, for, I mean, what,
yeah,
a good 20, 30 minutes, maybe, you know, into the film, and to redeveloping, you know, relationships with his brother and his sister-in-law, and ultimately the most important relationship, and that being his son. And it was just so fascinating to me to watch them travel to find his wife and his mother, and how they were talking over walkie-talkies, you know, and then to climax the film with that conversation, and the way they did it was just, with the way he did it was just absolutely brilliant, you know?
And I'm starting to see, and even last night I was getting impatient with the film, and I think it's just because I don't have like a personal connection, and I just find it sometimes. If I don't immediately see the solve the riddle, or see the riddle what's operating behind it, sometimes I put it off as being artsy, for just being art's sake, you know what I mean, and being a little bit pretentious, and then I start to shut it out. And I think I even with Sam Shepard's stuff, I've read a bunch of his stuff, and I find it suspect sometimes, you know what I mean. And I think it's just that maybe I just don't, you know, they're from. Look, Wim Wenders is a German guy, I think, right? He's making a film about America. And Sam Shepard's this rough and tumble Midwestern or whatever, Texan or whatever. And so it's hard for me to, like, relate personally to this, you know? So, like, I didn't have anything to kind of relate to, you know, like you did. And so I had kept it at arm's length. But as this film, I watched it a couple of nights ago, and as it's sort of resonating with me, and as I sat down to try to think about something to say about it and what it might mean, it's really starting to seep in, and it is really becoming. I see it as a work of great magnitude.
It is. To me, it is. I mean, it was something. I mean, I didn't know what. You know what, Joe? It's like, and we've talked about this kind of stuff before. It's like when you go into a movie, you say this the best, man. It's like you don't. You know, the best thing to do is to not know anything about what you're about to watch.
And that was almost the problem with this, because I didn't know anything about it. You know what I mean? So I was like, it was like, oh God, fuck this.
Yeah. You know, I had no idea what I was getting into. And it's so funny, because the last couple weeks of my life, my two of my biggest screening film experiences was Paris, Texas, and Cheap Thrills, which is an entirely different kind of movie. But I didn't know what I was getting into. I didn't know what to expect. And it was extraordinary, you know, watching a film like that, because I idiotically ruined so many experiences, Joe, by knowing just a little bit too much about what I'm getting into.
I know we got a bunch of guys here, but I just a quick anecdote on that, right? So my daughter Lily has been really getting into horror films. She really like is taking a shine to them, you know. So I showed her The Sixth Sense the other day, even though, like, I know it's quasi-horror for, like, all you horror freaks out there or whatever. I know it's... Anyway, so I'm watching it with my daughter, and we watch it. I'm being careful. You know, of course, I'm not going to give the ending, to spoil the ending. So we're watching the whole thing, and then afterward, we're talking about it. She's like, oh, I already knew the ending because I saw on YouTube somebody talking about the 20 greatest films. I was like, oh, how could you watch that movie and know the ending, you know?
Right. Yeah.
It was just funny that you were saying that.
Yeah, that was a tough film to keep, you know, to keep under wraps, you know, after it got out. But yeah, that's you know, did she enjoy it regardless? I mean,
she did enjoy it. I think she did like it a lot. I think she liked The Exorcist better.
Oh, jeez Louise. Hey, listen, real quick, we're going to get back to Paris, Texas. The Exorcist, I still can't watch as an adult. Like, it was the scariest movie as a child to me. I'm still haunted by some of those images. So
yeah, you know. my daughter, we went to one of those haunted houses last year for a Halloween. I know we're getting off the track here, man. We went to the haunted house, and waiting in line, they showed every terrifying scene. You had to wait online for like an hour to get into this haunted house, and they showed the most gruesome, most terrifying scene from every horror film of the last 30 years. So, and they had never, neither of my kids had seen really horror films, and I just saw their faces. They went white as a ghost, and they were terrified, right? And then after that, that's it. They can't be scared anymore. And Lily's like looking for that buzz, like that hot button, like that drug of that horror drug to find, you know. That's why she's like, oh, let's watch this, let's watch that.
Right. Anyway, awesome.
Totally off the top.
So listen, we got a lot of people here with us, Joe. And first of all, Joe, it was really nice talking to you there for a few minutes.
Now let's get to the Tom Browbeer.
It was like, you know, two gentlemen having a nice dialogue there. But listen, I got so many people here, Joe. Who the hell should I go to first here? I'm like confused. I'm like looking.
Spin the bottle.
Spin the bottle. Let's get Barasa in, man, because, you know, he's one of the best cinephiles I know out there. So I'm curious on his take on this film. Hopefully he could, you know, talk a little bit about Wim Wenders, because I get the feeling, it's either going to be big fan or big hate. So Billy, let's talk about Paris, Texas a little bit. How'd you like Joe's intro?
I want to know, who the hell is Jeremy Garcia? I literally have no idea who this human being is on the show with me. Jeremy, who are you?
I do lots of like the social media stuff for The Cutting Room. I do my own podcast, and he's a
super fan. He's our number one fan.
How long have you been listening to the show?
Oh God. It at least 2 years, I think. I discovered the show with my girlfriend at the time. I had just shown her I had just showed her Antichrist, and that's the first review. I looked up the review. I found the review on YouTube, and because I was curious, like, what the hell do other people think about that movie? Because I was like all over the place, and then I heard that episode, and I was like, oh, these guys are really, this is a really interesting way to start a discussion. Like, there's not really any other way you can sum up that movie other than just like saying what was in it and just being like, I don't know. So I listened to a couple other episodes, and I was like, holy God, like, these guys are nuts, but they're really interesting to listen to.
Do you enjoy talking about movies more or berating Tom emotionally? If you had to vote on what side of the show is better, what would you say? It's a toss-up, isn't it?
Yeah, it kind of, like, one of my favorite episodes, and Tom's going to hate this, but one of my favorite episodes...
Here we go.
Is the Jan Svankmajer episode. Because it introduced me to Svankmajer, and I really love his work, and that episode is great. But I also really like episodes like Henry Portrait of a Serial Killer, where it's just completely nuts, like, the whole time. So
He is a super fan. That is amazing. Even I don't remember these episodes.
Yeah. What happened on Henry Portrait of a Serial Killer? I don't remember either,
Jerry. I believe that's the one where Max kept trying to... understand Billy, like he was asking Billy all these questions, like what's your job and all that kind of stuff, like, where do you work? And Billy was like, I get checks from the Cutting Room Movie Podcast.
Yeah, that's so, that sounds like me.
Yeah.
Well, there you go, Billy.
Well, Tom, to answer your question, I apologize. I had to find out who this person was. Jeremy, love to meet you. I actually am surprised and in total agreement with Joe on Paris, Texas. I've seen it maybe three or four times now, and it leaves me. When I first saw it in my early 20s, it kind of set me off. I think I also saw Wings of Desire first, and then I just went off on a Wim Wenders marathon for a while there. And I really liked Paris, Texas. I thought it was like a masterpiece and so forth. And as I've seen it more, I've had more mixed reactions to it, to be honest with you.
That's interesting.
The thing that I respond to the most is a foreigner's view of the American landscape, the way it's photographed. Mm-hmm. And the way he photographs California as a native son of the Southern California landscape, the way he photographs it is unlike anyone who is in movies would really photograph it. That's how Southern California actually looks. The overpasses and the hillsides the hillsides are just brown. It's just deathly brown most of the time. And then a rain comes through and it turns it green for a few days before going back to ugly brown. And just the landscapes, the neon signs, the fluorescent lighting, everything. It's like an alien landscape that he's come down to photograph for posterity's sake, you know?
Right.
The story itself, I don't know. I mean, I feel like the ending's a letdown. I don't understand it. Everything up until, sorry for spoilers and all that, but everything up to and including the conversation he has with the woman in the peep show room, I really love. And then the ending just sort of leaves me feeling like it was all sort of a cop-out, you know?
Yeah, well, you know, there's not much, you know, there's only, there's only two directions you could go in with that ending. And he obviously chooses a more set, you know.
I know Harry Dean Stanton was pissed about that ending because I think they sort of made it up as they were going along with the script. Yeah.
Why was he pissed? Yes. What did he have to say about it?
He wanted to be with the kid. He thought the character should have been with the family, you know? Like, he was upset that he wasn't.
Huh. Yeah. I just think it's like, the origin, you know, Joe, as you described it, like the philosophical version of what happens to him and everything, I think that's spot on. I mean, I feel it. I think it's a powerful thing. I think it's a human thing. I think everyone's experienced some version of that story or can place themselves as a certain character within that story and knows that situation between the husband and the wife and everything. But it just doesn't... For me, it doesn't really resolve itself into something more than the sum of its parts, you know? Like, I just don't buy that ending. I think
you know, man, I know that it's fucking ridiculous to be talking about these, like, giants like Wim Wenders and Sam Shepard like this, but I sort of feel Sam Shepard's stuff, man. Like, when I read a whole collection of his plays and I read his Motel stuff, and I enjoyed it, but I sort of sense, like, you know, this avant-garde theater stuff. Like, it's almost just...
It's a little too cute for its own good, I think.
I don't know. It seems almost baseless. Sometimes it seems... I got to go back. I feel ridiculous saying this, obviously, because the guy's held in such high regard. But I just feel like... I feel like sometimes, like, he's just being avant-garde just to... You know, for the sake of being avant-garde, you know what I mean? Like, and like doing like sort of, yeah, we're gonna have a movie where a guy walks out of the desert and not explain anything for a half hour. It's like, okay, it was because or why or you know what I mean? And like,
yeah,
and like it doesn't feel like there's like a good reason. And I'm not saying that it needs to be fully explained, but emotionally cathartic, I think, in a sense. You know?
I kind of agree. Yeah.
I don't know.
I mean, there's definitely also, like, I don't know the origins of the story, whether Sam Shepard intended it to be a movie from the beginning or not, but it's definitely... I know the tipping its hat to The Searchers and John Ford's films. That opening shot is Monument Valley, right?
Yeah.
And you're walking, you know, you're doing this helicopter shot from John Ford land into modern America, you know, like there's a very conscious effort to connect it to these old myths of the American West, you know? I mean, it really is a Western in modern day, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean,
that's what I was thinking, you know, I mean, especially with listen, I'm not a big Ford guy, but I'm familiar with The Searchers. I mean, even The Searchers, you know, the main elements of The Searchers seems to be in this film Paris, Texas, too, you know, about saving a young person and, you know, it seems that it definitely ties it.
Well, definitely in The Searchers, the main thing is a guy comes out of the plains, you know, the Nathan character, I think his name is, God, and his past is questionable. You don't know if he fought for the South or so you're not sure where his alliances are. Wow. And you come to try to unpack that, where he's from, and that is similar to what's happening here.
Yeah. I mean that's a good point, Billy. Because I kind of felt that too. I mean, but you know, it what I was curious about with him was whether he's aware of that, because he talks about genre filmmaking a lot.
He's such a smart dude, man. Yeah, he knows exactly. He was a landscape painter, by the way. You know, so like all this stuff, he's very conscious. I mean,
yeah,
he's fucking broke,
I wasn't,
you know,
sure, because he said, I mean, I was reading something where he said that he doesn't like to put like the idea of genre into his movies. That so he's, you know, he claims to be somewhat unaware of any of that while he's making film. But you think that that's impossible, or?
I think the worst judges of an artist's work are the artists themselves.
Yeah, yeah.
Probably.
Well, you have to. I mean, you have to have amnesia and blindness for your own self. Otherwise, you'd never get anything done. Like if you were just busy analyzing yourself all the time, you'd never finish anything. So, but I do want to say the situation. Like I just have to tip my hat. The situation itself. A guy walking out of the desert with amnesia, going to find and being found and all this stuff. Like, that is one of the most original concepts for a film ever. And I think in some regard, the fact that it doesn't, that it doesn't amount to more kind of bugs me, because it's that opening and the idea of the story is just epic. It's like a myth, you know? And I just feel like it never quite lives up to its own... its own origin or something. I can't really put my finger on it.
Well, Max Cook brought Paris, Texas to the Cutting Room Movie Podcast. And this movie, Max, is a lot. I mean, from Girl House last week to Alone with Her, which we're going to be covering shortly. This is quite a different take on your theme here, to say the least.
Yeah.
I mean, it threw me off a little bit that you sandwiched Paris, Texas in between Alone with Her and Girl House.
Yeah.
So let's hear what you have to say about that, man.
Well, I wanted to explore the perils of men seeing women through smoke, mirrors, glass, and technology. That's what I was shooting for. And I just think a film like Paris, Texas, leading up to those catastrophically long conversation scenes between the window with Natasha, were all at once, you're tearing your hair out because it's so slow. But if you turn off your phone and turn down the lights and light a candle and just really lock into those two actors and what they're doing in the story, you really get a very sad sense of a family that is completely disintegrated. And the fact that it all comes together again kind of half-assed, you know, is also very, very sad. I mean, and it's so funny because I don't know if any of you have actually seen the commentary for Paris, Texas.
No.
No.
Well, I can provide some insights from the filmmaker himself, because this is one of those movies, man, that I just will watch probably once a year. I've seen it so many times, and it just over, like, I'll buy it on VHS and then I'll buy it on DVD, and then I just keep buying the goddamn thing, and then I'm like, I gotta hear the commentary. I gotta hear how this thing was made. There was no script. There were ideas. This thing was shot sequentially, which I think is amazing, because it was so important to Wenders to really get the sense of time with the actors, to really breathe with it. So much improv. Trivia. Hunter Carson is the son of Kit Carson and Karen Black.
Yeah, that's crazy, man.
So Kit was on set with Hunter, playing little Hunter, and he's basically working with Vim on the kid's dialogue. Sam would just come in and say, yeah, that's good. Yeah, let's do that. He was more like a structural guy. But in the commentary, Vim talks about, I wanted to shoot California. I wanted to tell a story I wanted to go on a journey. And I wanted Robbie Mueller, because I got to tell you, that cinematography is probably some of the best I've ever seen in the history of anything.
For sure.
And I think that's what just knocks. And Billy, you fucking nailed it on how that dude shot Southern California. I mean, I'm living in it. I mean, that is it.
If you live there, it's funny. Like, living in New York, you watch movies. Nothing looks like New York in the movies. It looks like a Hollywood. It looks like a Disneyland version. And same with Southern California. And you watch that movie and you're like, my God, that's what it actually fucking looks like, you know?
I'm telling you, fellas, if you have any desire to go further with this film at any point, I would really recommend listening to Vim's commentary. It's fascinating, but even more so, and he keeps saying it in the commentary, I really wanted to, he sounds like Werner, you know, I really wanted to do this here, and then I wanted to do this here, but I had to lose this here, so hopefully it'll show up on the deleted scene. Those early scenes are I think that's the crux for me. Just watching Dean and Harry Dean do their shit together as the brothers.
Yeah, that's great.
Figuring out their shit, little scenes like, there is a scene that wasn't in the film that it's criminal that it wasn't there, where basically you see Dean go out to the hardware store to get Travis an outfit, but it's basically a fashion show. They're in a shitty little desert motel room, and Dean's given Travis Levi's 501s and a flannel shirt. All right, we'll walk around the room for me. We'll pull this up. Now you got to put your belt on, and we're going to go out to dinner next. And it's like, this guy was wandering the desert, and now he's being forced into this, back into this reality that he's run away from this whole time, you know?
Yeah.
And it's all happening in the belt and the jeans and the greasy diners and the haircut. Oh, there's a whole endless scene where Harry Dean, he's taking him to get his beard shaved off. It's fascinating. Seriously. And it's funny, too, because Vim pronounces Dean Stockwell's last name as, and then it was fun to Dean Stockwood. Really, Vim?
I know Vim Wenders was hesitant to cast Harry Dean Stanton in this role.
You wouldn't know it from his commentary, because he fucking jerks off all over the dude. He's like, oh,
is that right?
Harry Dean, his face, his voice. Yeah. I was so excited when Harry Dean could finally talk, because he has such a warm, beautiful voice.
Is that right? Okay. Yeah, I heard otherwise. I think these guys are all a little bit full of it. You know what I mean? telling their stories and all that.
I fucking love Harry Dean Stanton. I love him.
I met that dude.
I love him. And you know what? It's so funny that you mentioned that Wenders talks about that voice and just him and being on screen. Because after watching Paris, Texas, I just played all these moments in my head from all these movies that I've watched him in over the years. And I just was just like, anything from like Christine to like his run on Big Love, or just that scene he has in that film Red Dawn. I mean, and so on and so forth. Like
Straight Story. He's Straight the brother.
Story. Straight oh Story. God. Yeah, that's a great.
Repo Man.
Yeah, I mean, even he just elevates his presence in just a really bad 80s movie, like Pretty in Pink. Like, he plays Ringwald's father, and he's like this depressed, like, dude, it's a really great performance. Like, he's just a guy that refuses to get out of bed, and he's all scraggly looking, unshaven, and just dirty, and like he can't get his life going because his woman left him. And he's like, this movie, he's just like bringing all that to the table, and this dumb movie, it just says,
hey, Matt,
says a lot about him. Sorry,
Max, you said that you had met him. I was watching an interview, and I remember you saying this, is that he gave you advice or something that in the interview that I saw, yeah. He was like, oh, anybody could be an actor if you have a good director, you just be yourself.
Play yourself. You know, something. That's what he does. Yeah. He plays himself.
How did you end up meeting him, and what did he?
I went to a very special Peter Hastings, who directed me in the Kung Fu Panda show, he actually shot a segment of the Harry Dean documentary that's actually streaming on Netflix right now. So Peter shot the sequence where Harry Dean is reconnecting with Kris Kristofferson, and the two of them are sitting on the couch and they're having a good time and they're getting stoned. And there was a screening of the film and a live performance by Harry Dean subsequently at the Grammy Museum. So it was sort of an evening with Harry Dean. And that's where he kind of like got up on stage. He performed his music because, you know, he's an amazing troubadour. He plays guitar and harmonica and he sings. You know. Oh, and can we talk about this Ry Cooter score?
Oh yeah. That.
Well, anyway,
So he said,
what's the best advice you can give for an actor? He's like, be yourself. He said in Going South, because he's really good friends with Jack. Nicholson. It was Nicholson who said to him, Harry, you just got to play yourself. It doesn't matter if you have a mustache or a cowboy hat. You're just playing yourself. And that's what he did, and he's been doing it ever since. Yeah. That hangdog face.
So do you think that's true, that anybody could be an actor if they have a good director?
No.
No.
No, I think you need talent to be an actor. It's so funny. Lately, I'm getting a lot of messages from people. Hey, I want to get into voiceover. Hey, I want to get into acting. I just, you know, what should I do? Well, have you ever acted before? No. And I can't believe I engage with these fucking people. Well... Well, what do you think?
Who are these people, Max?
I don't know. These people. Well, but I just want to act. But my friends say I do funny voices. Yeah. Well, are you putting a reality behind the funny voices? Are you living it? You got to take a basic reading class to start. You can't even write. No, people. Not true.
Okay.
Philosophically, playing yourself. I mean, Jesus, I've been playing myself. In all kinds of things.
Right. Well, you got to take a part, no matter what art form you have, you have to delve in, man.
Yeah, you go deep inside yourself and that's how you get anywhere, I guess. I don't know.
Joe, you get that that Stanton theory, play yourself? You think?
I actually think there's some truth. Look, I don't think that anybody can be a great actor, but I think that with the right direction and right script and the right casting, if you could get almost anybody to work on film. Like, I mean, there's, of course, you know, you can't get, some people just can't, like, they're terrified of being on camera. But I really do think that if you know who's going to be on camera and you have a scene in mind, or you build the scene, you know, when you're shooting stuff, you build the scene around who you're working, you know, the vibe that's in there, what they're capable of, where you think you could take, you know, you play it by ear in a certain sense. You know, you can't be too rigid. And so, yeah, I actually do think in the right situation, with a good director, you can get a lot. People can work on camera. Like, you can get almost anyone to work on camera. But that's not to say that not everybody's going to be able to go out and, you know, be, you know, Robert De Niro or something like that. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Like, they might be able to get through a scene, Joe, is what you're saying.
Yeah, you can make it, you can build a character around them.
Well, you have to evolve into that. I mean, Harry Dean's a trained actor, you know. Jack's a trained actor. You evolve. You graduate to that point where you can just play yourself for the rest of your life.
Yeah. I think a variation on it would be Werner Herzog's. I think you got to make clarify the difference between being an actor and giving a performance. Herzog said everyone has one great performance in them. That's different from being a great actor, right?
Yeah.
So if you can get some, like, Herzog can go to Antarctica and interview a truck driver, and it's the most interesting character you'll ever see in a documentary that year, right?
Yeah.
But that's because he's pulling something out of that human being. That might be all that human being has to give a camera for the rest of their life, right?
But this happens a lot, yeah.
But it's one great performance, right? That doesn't mean that guy's a great actor and that all he needs to do is work with a great director to do that. That's a totally different thing.
Whenever I think about, like, you know, what you're saying, Billy, I always think of that dude that was because I was so fooled by this guy, that John Heder guy who was Napoleon Dynamite. Like, when Napoleon Dynamite came out, like, I enjoyed it. I thought it was a good little film, and I liked this guy's performance. And then I just realized, like, a few years later that's all he has, you know? So,
this is what we were talking about. There's so many instances of this, but I feel the same way. I know that there's a slight disagreement here, Tom, but I feel the same way about that guy in The Human Centipede, the big guy, the heavy guy. Like, I think that second one, he gives a great friggin' performance. And then I think it's, you know,
or buying the
no, kind of, no,
really,
no.
Man, no. I'm nuts. I must be losing my mind. Hey, listen, Max wants to talk a little bit about the score of this film. We still haven't heard what Jeremy thinks about the movie. So let's try to get that going here. Jeremy, how you feeling about Wim Wenders in Paris, Texas?
Well, it's interesting. Because, I'm kind of in that phase where I'm going back and finding all these, like, great movies and great directors and stuff. And I've really gotten into, 70s and 80s, like, German cinema, like Herzog and Rainer Werner Fassbinder. Like, those guys, I really love those guys' movies. And I kind of had a similar... and I've before this film, I've only seen Wings of Desire, and I really didn't like Wings of Desire. I think I need to. That's one I need to rewatch, because I had the problem where I thought that movie was slow, and I really didn't get it, or I didn't really connect to it. But this film, I really loved it. There was something about it that just really moved me. Like, there was,
can,
like,
you put your finger on what drew you in? Like, as I said earlier, there was, you know, just watching that child and kind of knowing what he was probably going through in his mind drew me in. Is there anything that you could put your finger on?
Well, I personally could. There's some of the stuff that the child did for me, but because, like, my father's been out of my life since I was like 3. So if I saw him now, I would probably it would be hard for me to kind of warm up to him like the kid was in this movie. But also I could connect to, I kind of got a connection with the whole, with just his loss. Like, he lost this person, he lost everything he loved, and then he just kind of shut down after losing everything. Like, I've been kind of in flux ever since my last relationship. I've been just kind of in a state of perpetual just I had the long beard, and like, I used to be out there and more like, I would more social, and I've kind of not been, I've been kind of more inward ever since that happened. Because of some thing, some things that were happening and all that stuff. So I think that was part of it. And also I think Harry Dean Stanton's performance really drew me in. There was a few moments in this movie where I was legitimately like moved to tears. Like I really loved it. And it made me want to give Wings of Desire a second chance, because because when I heard about Wings of Desire, I was like, that sounds like a movie I would love. And then I watched it and I was like, I was just stone faced watching that. But
Billy and Joe, Billy, you're a fan of Wings of Desire, right?
Yeah, that's another one I haven't seen in a really long time. But I mean, when I saw it for the first time, it was like an A-bomb going off in my head, you know, like it's just one of those movies where to this day I have a certain idea about camera work that I really love that comes from that. And I think guys like Alfonso Cuarón and that guy, whoever his cinematographer is, I never remember his name, but they're kind of doing the same. Who is it?
Emmanuel Lubinsky, I believe.
Yeah. He has a nickname. Cuarón is always calling him, but the way they do things, these long elegiac, steadicam moves that just create, in the slow editing and the slow pace, it creates a state of mind, you know. And Wings of Desire is fucking fantastic. Actually, when I finally got to go to Berlin last year, and I got to go to that spire that the angels stand on in the movie, and it was like, it's so funny how that shit gets in your head, and I was just like really emotional looking at it going, my god, like I saw that movie, you know, when I was 20 years old, and finally get to see what he was talking about, you know.
So Max, you really like the score. I mean, I'm sure we all could agree that it's an amazing score. What's interesting is that this is from what I understand, this is one of Kurt Cobain's favorite films of all time. It was one of his favorite films of all time, and
His favorite film.
It's his favorite film.
Did you read that interview that Jeremy posted?
Yeah. And this score, I'm sure, is that of many things why he would love this movie. But you mentioned the score earlier. I know you want to say a couple things about how it made you feel. So,
well, I just said how about that score, but I did have it on vinyl. And I would have given it to Kurt Cobain when I lived in Seattle when he killed himself. Maybe that would have saved him. Hey, Kurt, I'm just a couple doors down, buddy. I can run that record right up to you, and you can have it in your collection and not kill yourself. But Tom, I mean, can we go back to the theme? Did it make sense that I included this? I mean, I know it's very abstract in many ways, but did you get anything out of, for the first time, by the way, blonde Natasha Kinski in this film?
Gorgeous. Yes, absolutely stunning. Natasha, yeah. Back in the day, man, late like her 70s to late 80s period, 20 years of being the most amazing actress and beautiful person you ever want to look at. Unbelievable.
Yum.
She's amazing in this movie too. She does that Texas accent, and no European can do that, and she friggin' pulls it off. I don't know how the fuck she did that.
How about that hug with Hunter at the end with the fucking bottle of Heinz ketchup sitting on the TV? And and the whole time you're like, is Harry Dean standing on the rooftop of that garage looking up at this? He is, isn't he? Ouch.
I can't believe that Klaus Kinski produced that beautiful creature.
You're obsessed with that idea, aren't you?
Well, I did. It's a new idea. It's still seeping in.
It makes sense. I mean, yeah, Klaus is such a beautiful looking human being.
That's another show we got to do. Klaus Kinski with his Fitzcarraldo.
Klaus Kinski.
Yes.
You just do a Herzog Kinski collaboration night.
Yes, I agree.
Well,
we did
Nosferatu.
That's not enough.
I know, but
you have to do
Nosferatu show.
Do my friend Klaus Kinski and
my fiend.
Klaus Kinski. Amazing.
My best fiend. Sure.
Hey, Jeremy, don't you're going to introvert in to the point where you're not going to, you think you'll ever come out of it? Because I identified with what you're talking about. I mean, I've taken some hits, you know, I've suffered some loss in recent years, and I found myself being, and I'm not that guy. I'm the extrovert guy, but this is a very introverted film in countless ways, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. And it's interesting, because I actually just, before you guys called me, my ex actually told me, gave me some really great news that, really like kind of sprung me up, you know, she, ever since we broke up, she's had like drug problems and stuff like that, and it's really been hard for me to deal with the fact that of what she's going through, because she's gone through a lot, and that's really it's just complete, like, I don't know, but lately I've been like working towards getting out of this. Like, I've put in some job applications. I'm planning on trying to. I just moved again, and I'm trying to find a new. I'm trying to, but I'm actually like trying and like want to do things now. So,
is the good news that she's off drugs?
She's in rehab. She just got out of rehab. Now she's doing some like outpatient stuff like that.
Okay, what was she on? The pills, Jeremy?
Heroin. Yeah.
Started with the pills, right?
No, I don't know.
Benzos?
Heroin is a really big problem where I grew up in.
It's starting to become a big problem everywhere. And I think it's like, from what I understand, it's the catalyst that are all these prescription drugs.
Not only that, because of people's infatuation with pill popping and whatnot, they have this new, like, low grade heroin pill. They call them mollies or something, and they're so inexpensive, you know. So if you're young and, you know, you're basically, you know, your source of income is taking a $20 bill out of your dad's wallet, like, you know, it's real easy to go, you know, to someone you know in the neighborhood that would be distributing something like this and buy a couple of these pills, and, like, you know, you get all fucked up, you know, you get all aged out on.
Yeah, man, it's so crazy, because we passed through like a sort of a window, a heroinless window, when we were growing up, Tom, you know, like, I mean, there were people here and there doing it, but they were like the like freaks almost when we were kids, you know?
And then there was always this surprise, like, holy shit, that, you know, like, there was a kid in my class or the class above me that like was just completely, you know, a college going normal, you would see very normal type kid. And then it was like, holy shit, did you hear about this dude? He died of heroin last week. And you were like, fuck. And then there was always that other guy that was like, you know, yeah, well, that makes sense. And everything.
Yeah, but like, for the most part, it wasn't as like widespread. It wasn't.
And
as,
luckily too, because, you know, I'm thankful for that, because I have a very addictive personality and I've done all kinds of drugs, but I have never done heroin. And I'm like really thankful that I've.
That's what I mean. That was like the line you didn't cross. Like, everything else was fair game, but that was the line that you don't cross. Now
they for days, but you know.
Yeah, but now they head straight for that line. Like, that's it. They like. I bet you some of these kids are, haven't even smoked pot. They're popping pills. They go straight to heroin.
Yeah, I wonder if it's like that. That they're just like.
I think it is.
Yeah, right. It doesn't start out with like a couple beers and a cigarette. Then you have a joint.
No, they go right to the finish line.
Well, I don't know what was happening with her specifically. I moved, and like I kind of had like a panic attack, because I lived in the same place my whole life. I didn't know what was going on. I didn't know what I was going to do. And then she started dating this guy, just so she was with someone, and he got her on the drugs and stuff.
Yes, that happens too, man. That happened to you know, a brother of mine. Like, I don't even talk to this brother, and like, you know, he dated a girl that he was obsessed with, because he wasn't the type of person that was like, girls weren't coming to him easy. And he winds up getting this girlfriend who I knew was just not a good person, because she was doing that kind of stuff. And what happens? He falls in love with her and they move in together. And 5 months later, he's on heroin. She's doing the heroin. And then he comes home from work and he finds her dead in their bed. Whoa. You know, and this, and it's completely fucks you up. You know, it fucked him up bad mentally. He's, you know, it's just. It's just fucked up, man. It's just a bad drug, Joe.
I think it is.
Where are you?
Yeah,
I'm staying off.
Where are you? Like, where? What state or whatever? Like,
I'm in Ohio.
Ohio.
I lived in, and that's another thing too. Like, there's so little for like people to do around here. They'll just be like, you know, we're gonna do drugs because we're gonna do drugs and we're gonna get pregnant. Like, that's what everyone I know does pretty much. Like, they do drugs or have kids.
So is your mom laying a trip on you to get work, or are you just, you want to get work? Like, where are you applying? Like, Mickey D's?
The Family Dollar, and I'm gonna try a grocery store in town. Is like little jobs like that, like nothing.
I like the grocery store idea, Jeremy, because you get a discount and you're kind of like with a family. Because I am very into my grocery store people. Like, I always ask them about their lives and I listen to them, and I always ask if like they all like party after work together, and there's always parties going on with grocery store folk because they kind of are a makeshift family.
Yeah, and this grocery store also has like the, like, it, I don't know if this is common or not, but it has like the young guys with like the bow ties who take out the groceries and put it in the car for people.
Oh, that's cool. And you can introduce, and you can introduce all these bored Ohio folk to Paris, Texas, and
there you go,
art films.
Yeah, I'll be like, hey, here's Ali, Fear Eats the Soul, and they're like, what the hell is this?
So listen, if you've never listened to the Cutting Room Movie Podcast before, and this is your first time and you're listening to us discuss Paris, Texas, this is normal activity. We go from Paris, Texas to Klaus Kinski to heroin to grocery stores.
to grocery stores.
Absolutely. But listen, on that note, I want to thank everyone for talking about Paris, Texas. It was awesome. We do have another movie to get to before we call it quits tonight, and that movie is Alone with Her, and it stars Colin Hanks, and it came out in 2006. Billy Barassa is going to give you the introduction. So, Billy, let's hear it, man.
I have like a personal connection, and I just find it sus. Sometimes if I don't immediately see the solve the riddle or see the riddle of what's operating behind it, I kind of sometimes I put it off as being artsy, for you know, just being art's sake, you know what I mean, and being a little bit pretentious, and then I start to, you know, shut it out. And I think I even with Sam Shepard stuff, I've read a bunch of his stuff, and I find it suspect sometimes, you know what I mean. And I think it's just that maybe I just don't, you know, they're from, look, Wim Wenders is a German guy, I think, right? He's making a film about America. And Sam Shepard's this rough and tumble Midwesterner or whatever, Texan or whatever. And so it's hard for me to, like, relate personally to this, you know? So, like, I didn't have anything to kind of relate to, you know, like you did. And so I had kept it at arm's length. But as this film, I watched it a couple of nights ago, and as it's sort of resonating with me, and as I sat down to try to think about something to say about it and what it might mean, it's really starting to seep in, and it is really becoming, I see it as a work of great magnitude.
It is, to me. I mean, it was something. I mean, I didn't know what, you know what, Joe, it's like, and we've talked about this kind of stuff before, it's like when you go into a movie, you say this the best, man. It's like, you don't, you know, the best thing to do is to not know anything about what you're about to watch.
And that was almost the problem with this, because I didn't know anything about it. You know what I mean? So I was like, it was like, oh God, fuck this.
Yeah. You know, I had like no idea what I was getting into. And it's so funny, because the last couple weeks of my life, two of my biggest screening film experiences was Paris, Texas, and Cheap Thrills, which is an entirely different kind of movie. But I didn't know what I was getting into. I didn't know what to expect. And it was extraordinary.
Warning. To say anything about Wim Wenders' 1984 film Paris, Texas is to spoil it. In order to not spoil it, all that can be said is that there is a man wandering in the desert when the film begins, and that this man is wasted and nearly erased. To say anything more would be to undermine the tension around which the film is coiled.
to spring loose its energy and thus destroy it, because the film is that tension. No, it is not Hitchcock's ticking time bomb. Rather, Wenders and Sam Shepard, who wrote the script, winds this tale taut around what we might discover about this lost man, what he must discover about himself, what has made him so lost, if he is irrevocably so. This man, played by Harry Dean Stanton, who he was, emerges slowly, eternally, like the face of God from Rock Canyon walls at the measured beatings of Santa Ana winds. This man has a brother who coaxes him back to the living. This man has a son. This man once had a beautiful wife. As the man once more realizes these facts of his life, his soul takes form again, like bones brushed free of dirt in an archaeological dig, taking the form of the once alive. At length, the man sets out upon the road into the landscape, this time with his son. This time, not to become lost, but to face what has broken him, what has broken his family, to possibly mend what has been broken. The man finds that what has broken him is a love-ravaged imagination of great...
Beginning with Stanton wandering out of... wandering out of the desert, like some kind of a beaten, biblical figure.
Yeah.
And the mood is very Western-like, which is... I don't even know if Wenders is aware of any of this. I don't know much about the man except for what I've been learning now after watching Paris, Texas. I had not really watched any of his films. I did realize after getting to know him here for this show that I did see a movie called Until the End of the World in the early 90s. So I had watched one of his movies. But back to Paris, Texas. It's so weird. It's so different.
It's a tough film to wrap your head around, right?
It is, and it isn't.
For me,
I was certainly able to relate to the young boy in a lot of ways. Growing up fatherless, and my mother, she partied a lot. She was a dancer, and she wasn't around a lot. She kind of left us to fend for ourselves at one point. There's a lot in this film that I could relate to on a personal level. Right. And not to listen, there's so much more than that in this movie, which makes it amazing. But it wasn't difficult. What's interesting to me, Joe, and listening to your intro, is that you had a difficult time with this for what, one or two screenings before?
Yeah. Well, even for this screen, I've seen it. I saw the first time I watched it, I didn't even watch it all the way through, to be honest with you, man. It was a while ago. It was like a good 10 years ago or something. And let me tell you, Wenders' Angel, it's not City of Angels, it's Wings of Desire. Is probably one of my favorite films. Like, it's definitely up there in like the top fivers or so. It's one of my favorite films. So it led me to this film. And it's just so slow and so at arm's length that I didn't even watch it to the end. And, I don't know if it was I was tired of watching too many movies. This is back when I was watching like 3 or 4 movies a day. It seemed like artsy-fartsy bunch of pretentious nonsense. Yeah, I know.
It's all about communication in a sense, I mean, to me it was...
Yeah,
with Stanton, His character, being mute,
yeah,
a good 20, 30 minutes, maybe, into the film, and yeah, to redeveloping, relationships with his brother and his sister-in-law, and ultimately the most important relationship, and that being his son. And it was just so fascinating to me to watch them travel to find his wife and his mother, and how they were talking over walkie-talkies, and then to climax the film with that conversation, and the way they did it was just, with the way he did it, was just absolutely brilliant,
And I'm starting to see, and even last night, I was getting impatient with the film, and I think it's just because I don't
and terrible power. Gazing at the fearful beauty of his wife, the man had seen in her something she wasn't. He imagined her a tramp. He imagined her an infidel. He imagined her as someone who could not possibly love him. Love will make us imagine that which will kill us. Sitting behind the two-way mirror at the peep show where she works, he does not gaze again upon his wife. He knows the destruction such gazes can produce. Instead, he gazes inward. What he finds is that when the cold face of his imagination met the hot front of his love, it produced a force of nature no less destructive than a Bible Belt twister. It was this force that caused him to evacuate his life, a jealousy-spun rage. The man recalls his father. He recalls that his father, by some contortion of his own imagination, came to believe that his mother was from Paris, France, instead of Paris, Texas. This makes sense to the man now. He recalls that he himself was likely conceived in Paris, Texas, and that this was likely where he was trying to get to when he wandered the deserts. It is to this place he sets out for again. This is a beautiful and haunting film that I didn't like either time I tried to watch it, but which I now feel attaching itself to my heart.
Little different introduction from Joe Christiana this time around for their season 5 finale, Joe. That was very, very soft and elegant.
Thank you, Tom.
You're welcome. This is an extraordinary piece of work, to say the least.